This conference will now be recorded.
Good evening, dear all. So I think today all the participants are there. Vidushi is there, Anaka. Then Prema Kumari is there. Also Shalini. And then, yeah, Mauniya, all are there. Fine, good. So in the last class, we have started the topic microbial fermentation. Hope all of you remember. Yes. So this was your syllabus. Fine. There is we started the first unit 12, that is applied biology. First topic, that is microbial fermentation and production of small and micromolecules. So that was the topic we were dealing with. Now there, the topic microbial fermentation, we will complete it today. Then regarding the production of small and macromolecules, so that is actually a vague idea they have given. So you have to study about microbial fermentation of certain products. So I will be taking like pharmaceuticals, hormones, vaccines, most of the important topics I will cover. You also have to refer some reference textbooks you have to go through. Because you have to learn as much as microbial fermentation as possible. So what they will be asking for your exam, we may not be able to tell whether they will ask from pharmaceutical or they will ask from vaccine or they will ask from hormone or they will ask from beverage, because they have not specified anything. Just microbial fermentation and production of small and macromolecules. So we will discuss as far as possible. Fine. So in the next topic B, you can see in the topic B also, they have given vaccines. So that also we will cover together with this. Okay. Then, like that we will continue. Fine. So we have gone through fermentation. Regarding the introduction of fermentation, hope all of you remember. Fermentation process, fermentation medium, about the nutrients or raw materials used for fermentation, regarding aeration, then fermenter design, pH control and temperature regulation during fermentation, phases of bacterial growth. Yeah, I think we have completed till phases of bacterial growth, right? Can anybody recollect till where we have completed in the last class? Is it regarding the phases of bacterial growth? Yes, Shalini and Vidushi. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you. So once again, I'm just giving you a brief introduction regarding the growth curve. Fine. So growth curve consists of 1, 2, 3, 4 phases. Okay. So when we are inoculating a culture of bacteria in a medium, whether it is a solid medium, a nutrient agar plate, a nutrient agar broth, whether it is a test tube or a conical flask, anything, fine. This is the way how bacteria will grow. The first initial phase, that is lag phase. You can see the lag phase here. Already we have explained this thing. Till here, this is the lag phase. Till here, fine. You can see the lag phase. So lag phase, it is the initial phase where what is happening? The bacteria, the newly inoculated bacterial cells will prepare for multiplication. It will prepare for photosynthesis. It will start utilizing the nutrients of the media. So the initial phase, there is no increase in number of living bacterial cells in this phase. Whereas when it comes to log phase, that is still here. So log phase is maybe 1. Okay. Now log phase is still here. You can see this is the log phase. So that is number 2. There is a second phase. Fine. So in the log phase, what is going to happen? In the log phase, there is an exponential increase in the number of living bacterial cell. Active bacterial multiplication will take place during the log phase. That's why we call it as exponential phase. Fine. The cell division will take place very fast. 1, 2, 2, 4, 4, 8, 8, 16, 16, 32, 32, 64, 64, 128, like that. Fine. I'm sorry, 138 like that. Fine. So that is the second phase. Now the third phase is nothing but the stationary phase. You can see this is the third phase. So in stationary phase, what is going to happen? The rate of division or the rate or number of rate of cell division is equal to rate of cell death. So in the lag phase, no cell division takes place, only enlargement of cells, bacterial cells, takes place in the lag phase. Whereas in the log phase, active multiplication or cell division will take place. Whereas in the stationary phase, the cell division, the rate of cell division is equal to the rate of cell death. Whereas this is the last phase, that is the death or decline phase. Fine. So this is the fourth phase, death phase, or there is decline phase. Now, where, what is happening there? There's an exponential decrease in the number of living bacterial cell. So in lag phase, there's an exponential increase in the number of bacterial cell. I mean, sorry, in the log phase, there's an exponential increase in the number of bacterial cell, whereas in death phase, there's an exponential decrease in the number of living cells because all the nutrients has been depleted. Now the end products or the metabolites of multiplying bacteria will fill the atmosphere, so that toxic substances, the concentration of toxic substances in the media will increase exponentially, which is directly proportional to the rate of cell death, so that the exponential decrease in number of living bacterial cells will also takes place in the death phase. Fine. So just keep your bacterial growth curve in your mind, and then we will continue today's class. So is it clear for you up to here? Right from the beginning of fermentation, is it clear? You need any further explanations in any area? Anatha, yes, two answers, three answers from Avinia. Then two more people have to answer. Anything you want me to discuss more? So Vidushi, Anaka and Mavinia, what about Prema Kumari? What about who is the another one? What about Shalini and Prema Kumari? Is it clear up to this point? Shalini and Prema Kumari, are you there online? Is it clear till bacterial growth curve? Yes, Prema Kumari. Yes, sir. Now, what about Shalini? Are you online, Shalini? I hope she is online and she has understood till here. So I am continuing. Fine. So now we will go to, yeah. So our phases of bacterial growth completed. Lag phase, log phase, stationary phase, and death phase. Now, what is the importance of this growth curve? Why we have to learn the growth curve? Because without having an idea about the growth curve, we cannot continue with our fermentation topic. Fine. Now, what are the types of bacterial growth culture? That's what now we are going to discuss. What are the two types of bacterial growth culture? The first one, we call it as batch culture. And the second one, we call it as continuous culture. Now, what is the difference between batch culture and continuous culture? Batch culture is nothing but our growth curve. That is nothing but batch culture. What do you mean by batch culture? We are cultivating bacteria in batches. For example, you take 10 ml of nutrient agar broth in a test tube and you inoculate a loop full of bacteria. You incubate it. What is happening? First of all, lag phase will take place, then log phase, then stationary phase, then death phase. That is within 24 to 48 hours, it will reach death phase. That is nothing but your batch culture. It resembles typical bacterial growth curve. See, it resembles typical bacterial growth curve, which involves lag phase, log phase, stationary phase, and death phase under conditions in which a fresh media is inoculated with a bacteria. For example, a flask containing nutrient broth inoculated with E. coli. Already I have told you what is that. Nutrients are... Sorry, sir, I got a call. That's fine. I hope, Shalini, now the topic is clear for you. Till growth curve, we are continuing. Fine. So, nutrients are expended and metabolic product is accumulated in a closed environment. Fine. So, two types of bacterial culture can be there. Either that is in fermentation also. For example, batch culture resembles a closed type fermenter. Only we are adding media one time. We are inoculating one time. We incubate it. We perform the fermentation. We separate the product. That is nothing but batch culture. Fine. So initially, bacteria will start utilizing the nutrients in the fermentation media. It will start enlarging its cell size, which takes place in the lag phase. In the log phase, bacteria will start multiplication. So it will produce primary metabolite, then secondary metabolite again. Now, can anybody tell me what do you mean by a primary metabolite and a secondary metabolite? Anybody? Anybody? Can you tell me what is a primary metabolic? So whenever bacterial growth takes place, whether it is in a test tube or a petri plate or a fermenter, wherever, it will produce some byproducts or end products called metabolites. Fine. Metabolites are nothing but the product of metabolism. What is metabolism? Anabolism plus catabolism. What is anabolism? Building up of biomolecules. What is catabolism? Breakdown in order to produce energy. Is it clear for you, all of you? I hope all of you are listening. I didn't get any response from anybody till now. Can anybody tell me what do you mean by metabolites? What do you mean by primary metabolites? What do you mean by secondary metabolites? Anybody? Can you tell me? This is actually class school level questions, huh? Basic, maybe plus two level questions I am asking you. Can you tell me what are primary metabolites, secondary metabolites? Anybody? Anybody in the comment box? I hope you don't have. Fine, no problem, no problem. Suddenly, if you ask me a question also, I can also not give you the answer. Maybe I may have to refer. Fine. Yeah, okay. See, metabolites are nothing but the product of metabolism. So what is happening when a bacterial culture is growing in a media initially? Initially, in the lag phase, as I have already explained you, bacteria will start utilizing the nutrients in the medium and it will enlarge in the cell size. So metabolites, during that time, it will be producing, it will be getting ready for protein synthesis, it will be getting ready for multiplication. So for all those things, for the life activities of a bacteria, like protein synthesis, multiplication, etc., it has to synthesize certain chemicals. Directly involved in normal growth reproduction is primary metabolic. Very good answer, Anaka. That's it. Did you Google, Anaka, or you are telling it by yourself? Did you Google now? The answer seems to be Googled. So she is correct. Myself, very good, very good, very good, very good. Keep it up. So primary metabolites are nothing but product of normal bacterial growth, because primary metabolites are needed by the bacteria actually for its reproduction, for its multiplication, for protein synthesis, everything. Fine. Whereas secondary metabolites are certain end products or certain products like our antibiotics or hormones or enzymes produced by bacteria, which are not necessary for the bacterial growth and metabolism, but it is necessary for us. We grow bacteria in large fermenters in order to separate these secondary metabolites in bulk. Is it clear now? So whatever, usually there are some useful components for humans which bacteria produce as primary metabolites also. I do agree, but mostly now when we start learning about fermentation, you will come across this term, secondary metabolite. Okay, antibiotic was produced as a secondary metabolite by the bacteria, so you have to know what is secondary metabolite. Secondary metabolites are nothing but end products produced by the bacteria by utilizing the nutrients, of course, during its normal growth phase. But secondary metabolites are not directly needed by the bacteria, but it is having some valuable use or commercial use for humans. Like example, antibiotic, hormone, enzyme. Clear? Primary and secondary metabolite, is that clear to all of you? What is happening when bacteria grow? Very good, Vidushi. Yes, thank you. So the same thing. So now we were discussing about the batch culture. So in batch culture, what is happening? The same thing, whether it is in a fermenter or a test tube or a conical flask or a petri plate, we will inoculate the bacteria. Bacteria will start utilizing the nutrients. It will increase its size, cell size, in the lag phase. In the log phase, active multiplication will take place. In the stationary phase, multiplication rate is equal to death rate. And in the death phase, active death will take place. Whereas, so that is batch culture. Now, what is continuous culture? In continuous culture, fresh media replaces spent media, thus permit continuous growth of a culture. Okay, now, what is continuous culture? In continuous culture, what is happening? In continuous culture, we never allow bacterial to reach the death phase or even the stationary phase. We always keep the bacteria in the maximum, we will keep the bacteria in the log phase or exponential growth phase. So that, for that, what we had to do, why this stationary phase and death phase is happening? Due to the accumulation of poisonous byproducts or poisonous metabolic end products in the media where the bacteria are growing. So that if we remove the media, if we replace the spent media with a new media, we can keep bacteria in an active multiplication state. Such culture where we replace the fresh media with spent media, thus permitting the continuous growth of a bacterial culture, we term them as continuous culture. Is that clear now, the difference between batch culture and continuous culture? Is it clear? What is batch culture? What is continuous culture? For example, if we are growing bacteria in a conical flask or a petri plate, whatever we do during subculturing, that is nothing but continuous culture. Because, okay, we grow bacteria on a nutrient agar plate or in a nutrient agar broth. After 24 to 48 hours, we take a loopful of the bacterial culture and inoculate it into a fresh media. We are providing a fresh media for the bacterial culture to grow, as well as we are removing the bacteria from the poisonous end products into a fresh media. So we are providing fresh media as well as we are replacing the spent media. Such cultures are called continuous culture. Clear? Difference between batch culture and continuous culture. Is that clear for all of you? Then only we can move forward. So I have got the answer from Chalini, Vidushi, Anaka. Very good. Everyone now understood. Good. So now with these points in your mind, now there are two types of continuous culture method. What are they? The first one is turbidostat and the second one is chemostat. So we have fermentase which will work on the principle of batch culture, one-time culturing and product recovery. And we have fermentase which will work in the principle of continuous culture. That is, fresh media is replaces spent media, thus allows the continuous growth of bacteria. Fine. Now, two types of continuous culture are there. What are they? What are the two types of continuous culture method? Turbidostat and chemostat. First of all, what do you mean by turbidostat? What is turbidostat? Now, first of all, I will read it and then I will explain. Turbidostat is a system which includes an optical sensor which measures the turbidity of culture in the vessel and generate an electrical signal used to regulate the flow of fresh media into the vessel. Fine? And flow of spent media and cells out of the vessel. So in turbidostat, what we have, turbidostat is nothing but a continuous culture method. Just assume you have a fermenter or you have a container, whatever it is, conical flask or fermenter. There you have a sensor which can sense the turbidity of culture. So whenever bacteria is actively multiplying, it will produce turbidity if it is a liquid media. Have you seen turbidity in the nutrient agar, nutrient broth tubes or nutrient broth flask? Anybody, have you observed turbidity? Yes, Vidushi, I got an answer from you. Yes, sir. Any other person? How you will? No, sir. Shalini has not observed. Anaka has not observed. Now, two more answer. One more answer, I think. See, it's a common thing what we can observe actually. Most of you have not observed. Only Vidushi has observed. So just assume when you are taking a nutrient broth, how the nutrient broth will look like before inoculation? It's a clear media, right? Nutrient broth before inoculation will be very clear. You can see the other side of the conical flask or even the, yeah, it looks cloudy. Excellent, Vidushi. So whenever you inoculate a loopful of culture and then incubate it in the incubator, after 24 hours or 48 hours, if you observe the same media, it will look cloudy. Or if you shake the conical flask or shake the nutrient agar tube, you can see turbidity. You can see a cloudy appearance in the media. Have you seen it now? Anybody? Apart from Vidushi, have anybody seen that? After inoculating, after incubation, if you took the nutrient agar slant or even the nutrient broth flask and shake it, you can see a cloudy appearance of the same media. This cloudy appearance indicates the bacterial growth, which we call it as turbidity. Is that clear? What is turbidity? Because it's a common thing. It's a very simple thing. I'm not sure, because even the microbiology, biotech or biochem graduate first year students itself, they must observe it. I'm not sure whether why Shalini, Anaka and Maunia and even Prema Kumari, you had not observed the turbidity of a media. So is it clear now? What do you mean by turbidity? Yeah. So now what is happening? Now what is happening in a turbidostat? Yes, thank you. Now what is happening in a turbidostat? A turbidostat is provided with an optical sensor. So the optical sensor will measure the turbidity of culture in the vessel after inoculation and incubation. So based on the turbidity, it will generate an electrical signal. Now, what is there happening in the continuous culture? In the continuous culture, we will add fresh media into the vessel and we will remove the spent media from the vessel. So based on this electrical signal, the flow of fresh media and the removal of spent media takes place in a turbidostat. Clear? Turbidity and the electrical signal generated by the turbidity determines or regulates the flow of fresh media into the vessel as well as the flow of spent media out of the vessel. Fine, which means the number of cells in the culture controls the flow rate here. That is the most important feature of turbidostat. The number of cells controls the flow rate. So flow rate of fresh media or removal, that is also a flow rate. Flow rate of fresh media inside and flow rate of spent media outside is controlled by the number of cells in the culture media. Fine. And the rate of growth of culture is adjusted to this flow rate. That is quite natural. Clear? What is turbidostat? In turbidostat is provided with an optical sensor. It measures the turbidity of the media. Now, heavy turbidity means lot of bacterial growth has taken place and bacterial multiplication has taken place. Less turbidity means less bacterial growth has taken place. If it is heavy turbidity or high level or higher rate of bacterial growth has taken place, what is happening? It will produce maybe a stronger electrical signal so that fresh media will be added to the culture and spent media will be removed out of the culture. As a result, the bacterial culture inside the fermenter or the conical flask or the container is always maintained in a log phase or exponential phase. Clear? It will never go to stationary, it will never go to death phase. Is that clear? Turbidostat, all of you? What is turbidostat and what is the speciality? How flow rate is adjusted in turbidostat? Is that clear? Yes, Vidushi. Anybody have any doubt till this point? Yes, Maunia, thank you. Anybody, any doubt till this point? Yeah, I hope it is clear for you and we are moving forward. See, this is a picture of a turbidostat. Fine. How turbidostat works. You can see a reservoir of sterile media. This is nothing but our fresh media. Can you explain how flow rate is maintained once again, sir? Shalini, yes, definitely. You can see the picture. You have a reservoir of sterile media. You have a valve controlling the flow of media. You have a photocell here. You have the media with the bacterial culture here. You have a light source here. And you have an outlet of spin media. Now, Shalini, listen. Now, here, first of all, this is the photocell or the photosensor. It measures the turbidity here. Fine. If the media is heavily turbid, what is happening? If the media is heavily turbid, this photocell will produce an electrical signal, maybe a strong electrical signal. Based on that, what is happening? This valve will open and fresh media will be added to this container. Same time, spent media will be removed from this container. See, this is removed. Spent media is removed from here and fresh media is added from here. This all depends upon the turbidity of the media. If the media is heavily turbid, the signal produced by this photocell will be strong, which will lead to opening of this valve of the fresh media. So fresh media is added, spent media is removed. Whereas if the turbidity is low, which means bacterial multiplication is less, the signal, electrical signal produced by the photocell will not be that much strong, so that there won't be any opening of the valve, or there may be a partial or maybe a feeble opening of the valve. The flow rate will be very less, which will again control the multiplication of cell, which means the turbidity and the electrical signal produced by the turbidity are both are the important factors which will control the flow rate in a turbid state. Flow rate means flow rate of sterile fresh nutrient media inside the chamber and flow rate of used spent media from the chamber. Is that clear, Shalini? Now, turbidostat, is that clear? Clear? Yeah, is it clear? Very good. If it is clear, perfect. Fine. See, anybody, if you want me to explain maybe one or two more times, I am ready to explain, but make the concepts very clear. Okay. So this is turbidostat. So turbidostat is the first type of continuous culture. You have turbidostat. Second one. So here it is nothing but the turbidity. Fine. Now what is chemostat now? Chemostat is also a type of continuous culture method where the flow rate from a reservoir of a growth media is set at a particular value and the rate of growth of the culture is adjusted to this flow rate. So there, in turbidostat, turbidity determines the flow rate, whereas in chemostat, flow rate is pre-adjusted. Flow rate is pre-adjusted so that the rate of growth of bacteria directly adjusts with the pre-adjusted flow rate. Clear? Now, since nutrients are continuously supplied and end products are removed, bacteria never reach stationary phase in a chemostat, even in turbidostat also. In turbidostat, there is a possibility that bacteria may reach a stationary phase. Whereas in chemostat, bacteria never reach because the rate, that is the flow rate is adjusted. Automatically, the flow rate is pre-adjusted. For example, 10 ml of fresh media per 10 ml of fresh media, it is already adjusted. So the flow rate of the fresh media always takes place in the 10 ml. Whether you have a active bacterial multiplication or you have a less active bacterial multiplication, fresh media will be continuously provided in the same flow rate of maybe 10 ml. So that whenever fresh media is coming, what is happening? The bacteria which is already there, already in the last class I have explained you. Once the bacteria reaches the log phase or the exponential growth phase, if we inoculate the exponential growth phase of bacteria into fresh media, it will bypass the lag phase. Lag phase will not take place. Directly it will go to log phase or the phase of active multiplication. So here also, in chemostat also, the same principle takes place. Because the flow rate is adjusted, pre-adjusted. The flow rate is pre-adjusted. So that the bacteria which is there in the chemostat is always maintained in a exponential phase or log phase. So that the bacteria will never reach the stationary phase in a chemostat. It is always maintained in an exponential growth phase. Clear? Now, the feeding liquid media contains certain nutrients in growth limiting concentration, and the concentration of this limiting nutrient in growth media determines the rate of bacterial growth. Okay, there in chemostat, what was determining the rate of bacterial growth in chemostat? Yeah. Yeah, turbidity, very good. In chemostats, you can see here. Yes. The number of cells in the culture controls the flow rate here and the rate of growth of culture adjusts to this flow rate. Fine. In turbidostat, it is nothing but the turbidity or the turbidity can be again called as you can see the fresh media. Fine. Yeah, includes an optical sensor which measures the turbidity of culture in the vessel and generates an electrical signal which is used to regulate the flow of fresh media and the flow of spent media and cells out of it, which means the number of cells in the culture controls the flow rate here. So in turbidostat, the number of cells in the culture controls the flow rate, whereas in chemostat, the flow rate is already pre-adjusted. And as a result, the bacteria cell will always maintain in an exponential growth phase and never reach a stationary phase. And even since we are providing the nutrient media, you will have, since we are providing fresh media, there are certain nutrients in growth limiting concentration, which means in the fresh media, in the media which we provide, there will be certain nutrients. And this nutrient concentration will determine the rate of bacterial growth. The concentration or the concentration of the limiting nutrient in the media determines the rate of bacterial growth in a chemostat. Whereas in turbidostat, the turbidity will determine the flow rate. Fine? That is the difference. In turbidostat, the turbidity will determine the flow rate. Whereas in chemostat, the rate of limiting nutrient in the media will determine the rate of bacterial growth. Is that clear? What is the difference between turbidostat and chemostat? Any doubts? Anybody? Any doubts? Yes. Yeah. Vidushi. It's clear for Vidushi. Any other person? What is the difference between turbidostat and chemostat? Anaka, Shalini, Maunia, then Prema Kumari. Is it clear for all of you? Yeah, good. Thank you. If concentration is limiting them, how cells will be maintained in low phase? Okay, that's a doubt from the doubt from Shalini. If concentration is limiting them, how cells will be maintained? No, it does not mean that concentration is limiting them. Here I can explain. That's why I explained it once again. Fine, see. Now, the concentration of this limiting nutrient in growth media determines the rate of bacterial growth. Now, in chemostat, the media, fresh media is added continuously in a constant flow rate. For example, if the flow rate is 10 ml, 10 ml of fresh media will be always added to the container. Whether bacteria is actively multiplying. It is independent of the bacterial multiplication. Always 10 ml of media will be flowing in the container. So in this media, there will be some nutrients which will limit the growth. That is, growth limiting nutrients will be there in the media. But here, the concentration of limiting nutrient in growth media determines the rate of bacterial growth. Why they tell like that? Here there is no problem because always the media is added. Whereas just compare chemostat with turbidostat. In turbidostat, the continuous flow of fresh media is not happening. Only when the turbidity is high and the signal is strong, which means if the container needs fresh media, because whenever the turbidity is high means the cells or the bacterial culture will be in almost the stationary phase. It will be going through the stationary phase. Then only turbidity will increase, which means bacterial growth has taken the maximum. But here in chemostat, continuously the media is flowing, maybe in a constant flow rate, so that the limiting nutrient concentration is not having that much influence here, because always fresh media is being added to the culture. Is that clear, Shalini? If concentration is limiting, then how cells will be maintained in the log phase? Cells will always be maintained in the log phase here. Why? Just listen. In the chemostat, in the beginning, you have a media. Okay. I will explain it with the picture. Then it will be more clear for you. You can see the picture of a chemostat here. Fine. What all things are there? You have a media reservoir with fresh media. Inflow of fresh media is taking place. Pump. You can see. This is the chemostat vessel. Fine. So in the chemostat vessel, initially you have a media. Fine. You have started the chemostat or the fermenter, which is working based on the chemostat. Initially, you are inoculating the culture. Bacteria will start utilizing the nutrients. It will increase in the size, that is in the lag phase. Then it will enter in the log phase, active multiplication. So right from the lag phase, this flow is constant here. See, nutrient media is flowing constantly. And once the cells has cell has reached the log phase here, it will never go to lag phase again. The cell will be continuously continuing in the log phase and it will not go to stationary phase. Why? Media is continuously added here. So there is no lag phase, no stationary phase. Always maintained in the log phase. Is that clear now, Shalini? Is that clear? Yes. Yeah. Always the same thing is happening because from the beginning of a chemostat, fresh media is added to the culture vessel. Spin media, see, collecting receptacle, you can see here. Friend media, outflow of media and cells. Fresh media is added here. Spin media is removed here. It is happening continuously right from the beginning of a chemostat system. So that cells will never go back to lag phase. Cells will never go forward to stationary phase. It will be always maintained in the log phase or the exponential growth phase. Clear? That's all about chemostat and turbidostat. And you have fermentase which will work on both principles. It will work on the principle of chemostat also. That is a continuous system. It will also work in the principle of turbidostat, which is a closed system. Both type of fermentase are there. Clear? So that's all about turbidostat and chemostat. And then we have one more type of additional culture method, which is called synchronous culture. So what is synchronous culture? Synchronous growth occurs when all the cells divide at the same time. No, it is not like chemostat, not like turbidostat. We call a culture as synchronous culture when all the cells, how many cells are there in the culture, it will multiply or divide at the same time. How it is happening? By regulation of environmental conditions such as changing the temperature or by adding fresh nutrients to the culture as they enter the stage. So for synchronous culture is not a commonly used method, but there is a system called synchronous culture system where all the cells in a culture media or where all the cells in the media divide at the same time, which is made possible by either changing the temperature or environmental conditions or by adding fresh nutrients to the culture, which is done experimentally. Fine. There is one more culture system called synchronous culture. Just for your information, I have added this. You must not get astonished when you hear synchronous culture. What is synchronous culture? Synchronous culture is nothing but whether the cell multiplication of all the cells in the culture media will take place at the same time, which is experimentally performed by either by regulating the environmental conditions such as maybe changing the temperature, increasing the incubation temperature or decreasing the incubation temperature or anything like that, or by adding fresh nutrients to the culture medium when they enter the stationary phase. Whenever the cells in a synchronous culture feel like entering into a stationary phase, maybe they will increase the flow rate so that it will remain in the log phase or exponential growth phase. Clear all the three methods? So now we have studied about batch culture, continuous culture, two types of batch culture, that is turbidostat and chemostat, also about synchronous culture. Is that clear till this point? Everybody? Yes, good, good. You will have some multiple choice questions at the end. Huh? Then only I will come to know whether you understand it or not. Fine. So now today's presentation, yeah, it's almost not today's presentation. This topic, the first topic, microbial fermentation, is almost over. You have one more point, batch versus continuous process. So I have already told you, we have fermentase working on continuous culture system and we have fermentase working on batch culture system. So which one is more efficient versus? Now, choice depends upon economics of production and recovery of desired products. So it all depends upon what is our need. So if we need a continuous supply of the antibiotic or the hormone or the enzyme, we always have to go for continuous culture method. That means flow through fermentase, that is flow through fermenter means continuous culture fermenter, whether fresh media is added and spent media is removed. They are more prone to contamination. That is one point. So if it is a closed system or a batched system, less contamination will take place. Why? We have sterilized the fermenter. We have sterilized the media. We have added the sterile media into the sterile fermenter under sterile conditions. We have inoculated the microbial culture under sterile condition. then incubate it and perform the fermentation. It is a closed system. There is no possible, there is less possibility for contamination. Whereas when it comes to an open system or a continuous culture system, we are adding fresh media continuously and we are removing the spent media. So there is an opening and closing of system which takes place in the continuous culture system or flow through fermentase. As a result, there is a possibility of contamination. That is one point. Now, flow through design, that is again continuous culture system, provide a continuous product supply. So that is also most important. It provides a continuous product supply for commercial distribution. So if we need a continuous product supply, we have to go for continuous culture system, either turbidostat or chemostat. Fine. Or even synchronous culture method. Fine. So continuous process provide more efficient use of fermenter capacity. Yes. Because always fresh media is added, spent media is removed, product is recovered, all these actions or all these activities will happen simultaneously only in a continuous culture system. Clear? Now, whereas batch process will have significant startup time, followed by incubation time, followed by product recovery time. Because in batch culture, it's a closed system. We start, okay, sterilize the fermenter, sterilize the nutrient medium, then add additional nutrient medium into the fermenter, inoculation of microbial culture, incubation, product recovery. That's it. Only six steps in batch. Whereas when it comes to continuous culture, you have continuous addition of nutrient medium, fresh nutrient medium, removal of spent medium, removal of product recovery will take place in one area. So all those things or all these activities will happen simultaneously only in a continuous culture system. So that is about the difference between batch culture and continuous process. Is that clear for all of you? Yes. Is it clear? What is the difference between continuous culture and batch culture? All of you? Yes, Ridushi, Maunia, Naka. Okay, now we will go for a couple of multiple choice questions based on this. Okay, so I will ask you I will ask a single person, she has to answer. Fine. So we had done up to I think here also we completed. Yeah, so this also we have completed. Yeah, fifth question. Yeah, okay. Answer has to be given by Vidushi. Okay, the question for you, Vidushi. Bacterial growth never stops in batch. A, continuous culture. B, batch culture. C, both. D, none. Bacterial growth never stops in batch. Vidushi, give me the answer. Bacterial growth. Okay. Bacterial growth never stops in batch. Continuous culture, batch culture, both, none. Vidushi has gone for C, both. Okay, now the question will pass to Anaka. Give me your answer, Anaka. Bacterial growth never stops in dash. Continuous culture, batch culture, both, none. It is already answered in the previous class. No. This question we have not taken. We have taken four questions in the last class. Maybe you have gone through my presentation and you see this question, Anaka. Okay, give me the answer, Anaka, anyway. If you know the answer, give me. Yes, Anaka, what is your answer? I had some network issue. Okay, then go for Maunia. Can you give me the answer for this one? Maunia. I thought first question. Okay, Anaka has given me the answer A. That is continuous culture. Maunia has given me the answer A, continuous culture. So Vidushi has given me the answer C. And what about Prema Kumari? What about the rest of the two? Prema Kumari and one more person is there. Prema Kumari and Shalini, give me your answers. Prema Kumari A, capital A Prema Kumari, okay? Oh, okay, small a, fine. Then what about Shalini? Shalini also A. So what about our Vidushi? Vidushi, did you understand? Any idea about the answer why it come A, Vidushi? Yeah, see, continuous culture, batch culture is a closed system. Continuous culture is an open system. In batch culture, only one batch. Media addition, yeah, you know that. Media addition, so all of you know what is the answer, fine. Because continuous culture, we are adding fresh media and we are removing spent media, that's it. Next question goes to Shalini. Next question goes to Shalini. Okay, the concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash. Chemostat, turbidostat, both none. The concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash. Concentration of a nutrient. Shalini, give me the answer. The concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash. Yes, Shalini, your answer. Concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash. Chemostat, turbidostat, both none. Shalini has given me the answer both. Concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in both. Very good. Then what about the answer of Prema Kumari? All other person, give me your answer for this question. All other four. Prema Kumari, Maunia, then Vidushi. Rest all, give me your answers. Prema Kumari, Shalnia, Maunia, Anaka, everyone give me your answers for this last question. So Maunia has given me the answer A, chemostat. Shalini has given me the answer C. What about the others? The concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash. Prema Kumari has given me the answer D. That is none. Okay, very good. So, two more answers. Vidushi A. One more answer. Anaka A. Okay, let me go back to the slide once again. See, in chemostat, I have read this in the last area. Even we discussed it. The feeding liquid medium contains certain nutrient in growth limiting concentration, and the concentration of this limiting nutrient in growth determines the rate of bacterial growth in a chemostat. Already we had discussed this thing. Fine. So now you read this question once again. The concentration of a nutrient, I didn't tell you limiting nutrient, I just write the concentration of a nutrient controls the bacterial growth in dash, whether it is chemostat or turbidostat or both or none. Anyway, see, when a question comes with chemostat or turbidostat, you won't get both or none. You will get either chemostat or turbidostat. Here it is nothing but the chemostat. In chemostat, we are continuously adding the nutrient medium. In the nutrient medium, there will be some growth limiting nutrients which will control the rate of growth. That's it. But the cells will never reach the stationary phase, since from the beginning till the end we are continuously supplying fresh medium and we are removing spent medium. Is that clear, all of you, this question? All of you, is that clear? Because most of you got confused in this question. It was a direct question, but still. So I hope so. Is there any doubt till this point? Now, any doubt in this point from the first presentation of fermentation, microbial fermentation? Any doubt you want to ask me, you can ask me now. If you have any doubt from any area in this topic, because I am just going to start the new topic today and then we will wind up today's session. Is it clear, all of you? No doubt? Sure. Vidushi? Any other person you want me to explain any point once again? Turbidostat, chemostat, continuous culture, batch culture, synchronous culture, fermentation medium, fermenter design, agitation, aeration. So is that clear for all of you? Shalini, Anaka, Maunia, Vidushi, all of you. Very good. So that's all about our this presentation today. Okay. And I will just start the new topic today and then we will wind up. So now we have completed. Now we have completed fermentation. Fine. Now we have to study about the fermented products. As already I explained, you have to study about production of macromolecules and micromolecules. Fine. You have a topic in syllabus. So today we are just going to start the microbial fermentation. First of all, first category is pharmaceuticals. Okay, now we will start it today. What are all the pharmaceuticals? Okay, now what are the pharmaceuticals? Pharmaceuticals include antibiotics, then steroids, vitamins, vaccines, etc. from microorganisms or microbes. So all those things we have to. So when, since they have studied, since they have given in the syllabus, production of macromolecules and micromolecules by microbial fermentation, we have to learn few products. So I will cover few products, important products in the classes. You people also please go through the reference text, okay, and try to study maximum fermented products for the exam. They can ask from any area. Fine. So today we are going to start the production of pharmaceuticals. So pharmaceuticals, what are pharmaceuticals? It include antibiotics, steroids, vitamins, vaccines. All those things will come under the general term pharmaceutical. Now all these products are produced from microorganisms. Fine. First of all, let us start with antibiotics. Now before going to antibiotics, tell me what are antibiotics. Just give me an introduction. Just give me your idea about antibiotics in the comment. What do you mean by an antibiotic? Is it a chemical? Is it produced by microorganism? What is the function of antibiotic? What are antibiotics? Anybody? Anybody, can you tell me what are antibiotics? Any idea? Antibiotics used to treat diseases. Shalini, very good. Then Anaka, acts against bacteria. Very good. Yes. Any other opinion of antibiotics? Chemical against antigen. Chemical. Is it a chemical, Maunia? Is it a biomolecule or a chemical molecule? Substance synthesized by microbe to kill bacteria. Vidushi. Okay. I agree. Okay. Fine. Enough. So antibiotics are substances synthesized naturally by various, yeah, biomolecule, Maunia. Yes. Various microbes, which has the ability to inhibit or kill other microorganisms. So microorganisms, certain microorganisms which can stop the life cycle of bacteria. Okay, Priyama Kumari, good. So certain microorganisms, when during its metabolism, they will produce certain substances, biomolecules. We call it as chemical substances. Chemical, that is why chemical, every substance is chemical in origin, right? But this is not artificial chemical, it is a chemical synthesized, that is microbe chemical from microbial origin. Antibiotics are chemicals from microbial origin, which is produced by certain microorganisms, which can inhibit or kill other closely related or distant genus of microorganisms. For example, antibiotics produced by gram-negative bacteria can inhibit gram-positive. Antibiotic produced by gram-positive bacteria can inhibit gram-negative. Antibiotic produced by fungus can inhibit bacteria similarly. Is that clear? Antibiotics are certain chemical substances of microbial origin produced by certain microorganisms, microbial family, which can inhibit or kill certain other closely related or distantly related microbial genera. Clear? What are antibiotics, everyone? Good. So today we are just going to see the production of penicillin, the first antibiotic. We will complete the production of penicillin today and then we will wind up today's class. Okay, now it's 7 o'clock. We'll take either 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, now penicillin. How penicillin is produced, first of all? So you can see an inoculum of Penicillium chrysogenum. So what is Penicillium chrysogenum? Is it a bacteria or a fungus or an algae or a virus or an actinomycetes or a protozoan? And what is Penicillium? Penicillium notatum, Penicillium chrysogenum. What is that? Anybody? Yes, Vidushi, very good. It's a fungus. Fungi. Okay, Vidushi and Prema Kumari. Correct. So, first of all, what we are doing, we are taking an inoculum of Penicillium chrysogenum fungus, which is produced by, now how we are preparing the inoculum? So we have, yeah, fungus, Anaka, very good. So we have heard a term in last class, scaling up of inoculum. So here also we are performing scaling up of inoculum. First of all, what we are doing, we are inoculating a dense spore suspension of fungus on wheat bran nutrient solution. Okay, we are inoculating maybe a loopful or a dense spore suspension of the fungus Penicillium chrysogenum on wheat bran nutrient solution, incubating it for maybe 3 to 5 days, and then we will get a inoculum of Penicillium chrysogenum. And this after inoculating this, we are going for incubation of 1 week at 24 degrees Celsius. And then, so this is the first culture. So initially, inoculation of dense spore suspension of fungus Penicillium chrysogenum in wheat bran nutrient solution, incubation at 24 degrees Celsius for 5 to 7 days. So we are getting an inoculum. This inoculum is then transferred into a inoculum tank. So that is scaling up from small amount to larger amount. Okay, inoculum tank. Now, what is happening in the inoculum tank? Spores may germinate to produce mycelia. Mycelia is nothing but the living fungal filament. That is nothing but the mycelia. Fine. So spores may germinate to produce fungal mycelia. Now, inoculum tanks are agitated with forced aeration for 1 to 2 days for a heavy mycelial growth for further inoculation into production tank. So initially we started maybe from a conical flask, then we went to an inoculum tank, then we are going to a production tank. So here we are providing in the inoculum tank, the spores of the fungus may germinate and produce a fungal mycelium. We are providing forced aeration for 1 to 2 days in the inoculum tank for a heavy mycelial growth. Once a heavy mycelial growth takes place, we are adding this inoculum into the production tank. So scaling up of the inoculum. So in the production tank, the real fermentation takes place, and the fermentation medium consists of 10% total glucose or molasses by continuous feed. So this is a continuous type of fermenter where we are adding the fresh medium and removing the spent medium. So here, see, now 10% of total glucose or molasses is a continuous feed. Then 4 to 5% of corn steep liquor solid is not a continuous feed. Then 0.5 to 0.8% of total phenyl acetic acid by continuous feed, again continuous feed. So we are providing 10% total glucose or molasses by continuous feed, 0.8% of total phenyl acetic acid by continuous feed, and finally 0.5% of total vegetable oil also by continuous feed. So three growth limiting nutrients we are providing by continuous feed, whereas one growth limiting nutrient, that is corn steep liquor solid, we are providing it in a one time. Is that clear? So now this fermentation medium, how we are forming the fermentation medium, already we had discussed in the last class, it must contain a nitrogen source, a carbon source, a phosphorus source. All those things must be there. That's why we are adding this many ingredients in a fermentation medium. Okay, so for the fermentation of penicillin, the culture used is Penicillium chrysogenum, which is a fungus Then incubation time, almost 1 week, 5 to 7 days. Incubation temperature, 24 degrees Celsius. Forced aeration also provided. Then fermentation medium consists of continuous type of fermentation with 10% total glucose, 0.5 to 0.8% total phenyl acetic acid, and 0.5% total vegetable oil by continuous feed, plus 4 to 5% of corn steep liquor solids. Clear? So, now what is happening while we are going for this fermentation? Now, continuous feed substrate increases the efficiency of penicillin production, because we need penicillin in a continuously. That's why we are going for a continuous feed substrate. We are performing the product recovery continuously. We need bulk antibiotics. We are always fermenting in bulk quantity. Now, phenyl acetic acid is a precursor used to form the benzene ring side chain of penicillin G molecule. So penicillin G is the normal penicillin which we make by fermentation. So in order to produce the side chain of this benzene ring side chain of penicillin G molecule, we need phenyl acetic acid as a precursor. Precursor is the starting component. Okay. Now, the pH of the media after sterilization is maintained at 6, which is neutral, because it is critical for penicillin, because penicillin may get inactivated in a low and high pH value. So if the pH will go to acidic or alkaline, it will inactivate the penicillin formed. As a result, we have to maintain the pH of penicillin fermentation in always 6, that is neutral. For that, we are adjusting it with alkali. Alkali addition is happening during the fermentation. Okay. Now, the incubation temperature is always maintained in approximately 25 to 26 degrees Celsius. Aeration continuously provided. Then 7 days, typical course of penicillin production takes place within 7 days. Now, production of penicillin is a secondary metabolite or etiolite. So what is a secondary metabolite? What is the difference from secondary metabolite from primary metabolite? Now you know. So here penicillin is produced as a secondary metabolite, which is also known as etiolite. Why etiolite? It is known as etiolite now. It is not required for fungal growth. Yes, secondary metabolites are never required for the growth of the producing organism. And it occurs after initial fungal biomass production in growth phase called. So the first phase in penicillin production is called prophase. It is nothing but the production of primary metabolite takes place in the trophophase. And now trophophase is succeeded by idiophase. That is after trophophase, after the primary metabolite production which happens in the trophophase, idiophase happens, where secondary metabolite production, that is accumulation of penicillin, takes place. So since the production of penicillin takes place in idiophase, we call penicillin as etiolite or secondary metabolite, fine, which takes place on the second day and reaches maximum concentration within 7 days. Clear? That's all about the fermentation of penicillin. So here, phenyl acetic acid will act as a starting component or precursor for penicillin, for the production of or for the formation of benzene side chain of penicillin G molecule, which is nothing but the commonly found penicillin G. Fine. Now, pH of the medium is maintained at 6, because penicillin may get inactivated at acidic or alkaline pH. As a result, we adjust it by the addition of alkali. Incubation temperature 25 to 26 degrees Celsius. Aeration continuous. Then total time required 7 days. In the first day, the production of primary metabolite takes place, and this phase is called trophophase, followed by idiophase, which is the production of secondary metabolites such as penicillin takes place, and accumulation of penicillin takes place, or accumulation of penicillin starts in the idiophase. Since it is known as etiolite, it starts in the second day and it will remain for the first 7 days. Clear? Production of penicillin. Now, so after fermentation, yes, good. We are continuing. Just one more slide, maybe. So after the fermentation, the liquid medium containing penicillin is separated from fungal biomass using a rotating vacuum filter. We are using a rotating vacuum filter for product recovery. Now, fungal biomass is separated from the surface of the filter drum, dried and marketed as animal feed. So we are, since we are separating the penicillin, you will have a lot of fungal mycelia, fungal biomass, which will be accumulated in the surface or top of the filter, which we will collect all the fungal biomass, dry it and market it as animal feed. Now, penicillin is recovered from the filtrate. Okay, we get the penicillin from the filtrate. Now, how we are extracting the penicillin? It is extracted from the solution using an organic solvent. We extract the penicillin from the filtrate using an organic solvent and extract it back into the aqueous solution. Fine. Now, exchange of penicillin between the organic and aqueous solvent is performed by altering the pH. When we study DNA isolation, we have studied, okay, recovery of DNA by altering the pH between the aqueous phase and the organic phase. Same mechanism happens here. Fine. And as a result of this recovery of penicillin between the organic and aqueous solvent by altering the pH, partial purification of penicillin will take place. And finally, potassium ions are added to the aqueous solution of penicillin, resulting in the formation of crystalline potassium salt of penicillin G, which is recovered by filtration or centrifugation. Now, filtered and dried penicillin salt is over 99.5% pure. So after all this organic extraction, aqueous extraction, and addition of potassium ions leading to the formation of potassium salt of penicillin G, the penicillin will be in the purest form. It will be around 99.5% pure. And the penicillin G produced can be further modified into various penicillin derivatives, either chemically or by microbial enzymes. So the initially produced penicillin or the commonly occurring penicillin will always be in the penicillin G form. It depends upon the side chain of the penicillin. Fine. So you can convert this penicillin G into any other form, either chemically or by the action of microbial enzymes. Clear? Finally, this is all about the production of penicillin. Clear? Right from the culture Penicillium chrysogenum into shaker flask, into transfer vessel, into seed tank, into fermentation tank. This is a pictographical representation. So see, from the shaker flask through transfer vessel, through seed tank into the fermentation tank, which means in this area, the scaling up of inoculum takes place, followed by recovery of penicillin, filtration, first extraction, second extraction, vacuum crystallization, ceramic filtration, all those will take place. Finally, you will be getting a crystalline penicillin after vacuum drying. Clear? Just a pictorial representation. So that's all about the penicillin production, and that's all for today. So today we have covered types of microbial culture method, bag culture, continuous culture, and then turbidostat, chemostat, and synchronous culture. Then batch versus continuous culture, and we have started the production of pharmaceutical, and the first one we have completed today regarding penicillin. Now we have lot of things remaining. Streptomycin is there. Then you have production of steroids, human proteins, vaccines, vitamins, all those things we will continue in the next class. And that's all for today. Over to the organizers. I hope it is clear for you till this point.
Okay, sir. Students, if you have doubts regarding today's class or today's topic, you can just ask, or rather you can comment yes. If you don't have any doubts, just let us know. Okay. Thank you for responding. That's all for today. I hope you all enjoyed. And you can slowly leave the meeting. Thank you, Vinayan sir. You can leave the meeting one by one. That's all for